Jennifer Zamparelli with you till 12. How's everybody doing? We have a whopper of a show for you today, but I have to tell you, before we kick things off, I think he's blown it. I think it's happened. Just reading in The Guardian today. I'm not talking about Varadkar. No. I'm talking about Aaron Taylor-Johnson, who we've been talking about all week, is in line to be the next James Bond. But apparently, he's blown it. So this is what it says in The Guardian. Just as the runners and riders were parading around the paddock, feeling deadly about themselves, showing off, Aaron Taylor-Johnson has sensationally dismounted and stalked back to the changing room, thoughtfully tapping his whip against his thigh. Oh, what happened? What did he do? Did his agent overplay things by sneakily leaking negotiations to the press? That's what they tend to do. Hoping this subsequent acclaim would nail down the whopping fee he was looking for. Did they get their bluff called? Who knows? Well, either way, the producers and the keepers of the Bond flame in their legendary offices in Piccadilly must now resume the search and once again study the crumbled and heavily thumbed form sheet to find the next James Bond. So apparently he has blown it. So you're telling me there's a chance, Cillian Murphy, there's still a chance for Cillian Murphy. That would be great, wouldn't it? We still would love to see another Irish man play the Bond. Come on, Cillian. Just say yes. Anyway, that's going on in the entertainment world. We have lots to talk about on the show today. We have DJ and producer Robbie Kitt in, and he's going to be telling us all about the Give Us the Night campaign. This aims to reform nightlife laws in Ireland with a particular focus on music venues. That's going to be good. Neve Shaw, our favourite space cadet and scientist, is going to be in, and she's going to be telling us why that movie, The Day After Tomorrow with Julia Roberts, do you remember that? Wasn't as far-fetched as it first seemed. Scary. And the lads are going to be here for Newsy Bits. We're going to discuss all the other topics that's happening today. Do not go anywhere.
Text Jen 51552.
If you need a good Easter Sunday morning song, me and the choir got one for you. Yeah, make some noise. Come on. I like the way that feels. Listen to this. I'm so excited, I'm so happy, overjoyed that Jesus loves me. Let's celebrate the Lord today. Oh, He washed my sins away. Oh, the blood He shed for me. Way back on Calvary. Listen,
Sometimes alone is all I've been. Tears I cry night and day, but God has always made a way, because he loves me and I love him too.
Job and my life was so very hard. Tried my best to stand the test. Then God came and gave me rest. Tears I cry night and day. God has always made a way, because he loves me and I love him too.
It left me living in fear. I didn't know how to pay my bills, but in his word he says stand still. Tears I cried night and day, but God has always made a way, because he loves me and I love him too.
I love you too.
I love you so.
Oh, Lord.
Welcome to Jen's Newsbits. This is where we bring you the stories of the day. What is happening in Ireland or in around the place? We go outside of Ireland. I'm here with the lads to discuss the stories.
Nothing happened. What happened in the last 24 hours?
Cormac, Graham are here. Actually, Cormac, you were in with your breaking. Cormac brought in some survey about parents. He was like, this is breaking news, Jen.
It was
breaking news. In the middle of his breaking news, Leo Varadkar resigned.
Bracker ruined your moment.
He ruined your moment.
I couldn't believe it. I had a bit of breaking news that was broken by broken news. Breaking news. It was a moment.
Yeah.
Talk about getting your thanks, Leo, for stealing my thunder of my amazing survey.
Yeah.
At 11:45 yesterday.
Yeah.
Because when you said there's breaking news, I thought you were referring to what I was saying, but you're actually referring to a real breaking news story about Leo.
Yeah.
But like all the headlines this morning are, of course, about Leo Varadkar stepping down. The headlines and all the papers about the shock departure yesterday, because it was a shock. When you said it to me here, it was about 11:46, I was like, you're having a laugh. I didn't think you were serious. I didn't know what was going on.
Excuse me, I'm a serious
podcaster. No, I understand that.
Yeah,
Walter Cronkite.
Thank you.
Jen Zamparelli. Some of the papers, the Star says, it's dull end in tears. So, and, oh no, the another one says, tea shock and awe. Yeah.
I don't get that.
Shock and awe.
Oh,
I think that refers.
Shock.
I think that shock refers back. Refers
yeah.
back to okay. George Bush and all that.
It's not great, no.
And exit stage. Leo says the Irish Sun. So
yeah.
Leo, he is no longer the best person.
They didn't have a lot of time.
Simon Harris.
They didn't have a lot of time. No,
no.
I played this by accident.
Yeah.
Well, you know.
Do you know what? He might be feeling like that.
Do you know what? Everyone's a winner.
Well, it's, you know, it's like, imagine the relief of walking away from the job of running a country. I mean, this morning.
But the legacy, you got to think about your legacy when you're leaving a job, I do think.
No.
You
know?
No.
No.
Just set a match to it, throw it at the building
and
walk out. Really?
Bye.
Wow. Okay. Okay, that's interesting.
Yeah.
But I wonder, the lads probably knew this, right? Like, this isn't a shock to them. It's not like he just walked down the steps and went, ta-da. I'm out of here.
Who's the lads? Who are you talking about?
His party.
Well, I think they found out. Well, I'm no political expert, but like I think they found out fairly late in the game. It was all arranged quite hastily.
But they probably had a bit more time than us.
Yeah.
Well,
when I go on to a bigger station that's going to pay me more money, you guys will be the last ones to know.
Thanks.
Because I won't be able to look you in the eye. I'll be too... Do you know what I mean?
You'll be wearing those things that horses wear, so you won't be able to see it.
Blinkers.
When are you moving to England? I didn't know you were moving to England.
No, in all honesty, it's a tricky one to navigate. I can feel the awkwardness from, like when he was doing a speech, he looked like he was about to cry.
Yeah, it did. I was surprised by his speech because I thought it was going to be, you know, Leo's quite, how would you say, he's not on a very. He hasn't been a very emotional kind of character.
Well, he can't be
as a leader. No, but some are. Some leaders are quite passionate about the way they deliver things. And Leo has always been quite stoic. But I think yesterday, the emotion of the event of actually saying what he was saying kind of it did. He did start to lose it.
And Graham, wasn't it weird with Simon Harris in the background dancing to? Like, that was weird.
That was strange, all right.
You know, I think Leo
in your imagination
was just a bit upset because no one had enough time to throw him a leaving do.
Yeah.
And they were just like, oh, sorry, we got you this...
There's loads of time.
We got you this Easter egg. see you later.
What would you get a former Taoiseach? Like, what are the lads going to get him? I mean... Would they all pool together? Would they all chip in and get him some airline tickets to help him on his travels? A calligraphy set. A pen of some sort.
Yeah, he definitely got a pen.
A nice cross pen.
Yeah.
Do you think
or
so?
A Mont Blanc pen.
Yeah.
I would say they'll organise a karaoke night, to be quite honest.
Why is that now?
I don't know. I just feel like, you know, Leo's likes his music. He's gone to he's into his cool music.
He likes Taylor Swift.
LCD sound system.
Yeah.
Does he like Taylor Swift?
Yeah.
He's got
Kylie.
Lots of
no,
cool
he's
bands.
Into Kylie. Like he was at the Kylie gig.
Yeah, so he's got a very eclectic music
taste
as well.
He does.
Give him a show on 2FM. He's got an eclectic music taste. Cillian Murphy has a...
That's the answer.
Cillian Murphy has
in.
A show, a radio show. Leo Varadkar should have his own radio show. Give me a radio show on Radio 1. A nighttime music
here?
Show.
Why not? Nighttime music show, yeah.
Yeah, why not? I'd love to hear his...
Kate reckons the lads are just going to stand around with cups of tea, like on his last day, and do that. Do that.
That makes awkward. Small talk.
Yeah, that awkward clap. And then he has to walk out of the room. There's no right way to leave a job, is there? It's always awkward, isn't it? Unless you get fired spectacularly, you know, or you're off. No, mental health. You know, it's very tricky to leave a job.
The best way is build up your annual leave, put in your notice, and you have enough annual leave so you just don't have to come in the next day.
That's why didn't he do that? Why didn't he do that? Do you remember leaving any jobs in particular?
HR on the radio, lads. Here we go. Love it.
I don't remember leaving any job.
You probably got fired from all your jobs. That's
why. How dare you?
Well, it's going to happen here anyway. I mean, that's showbiz. Yeah. I don't mean you.
You're so right.
That happens to everybody.
Yeah.
It's like politics.
No, I think they just stop answering the phone.
All showbiz careers end in failure.
Yeah.
They just stop answering the phone.
They do. They'll stop and they'll ghost
you. Not before I stop answering first.
Yeah, we'll see who's going to blink first, Jen.
Yeah.
Let's see how it goes.
But it's really awkward. Like, people have left 2FM in the past. And nobody knows what to do, really.
Yeah.
We need to have a set of rules.
Just keeps typing.
Yeah. Oh, God.
When I've left jobs before, it's kind of like you're having a wedding or a funeral with only like two or three people you actually like.
Yeah.
Because you have to make small talk with everyone. Oh, what are you going to do? Are you going to go on a holiday before your next job? Are you going to blah, 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 blah? And you have to do all the rounds. But there's only two or three people you actually get on with. And you have to make small talk 40 hours a week with those people, and then at the leave and do, you're just like, oh.
And the leave and do, they always do it midweek, don't they?
Bowling, Tullamore. There's a lovely bowling alley in Tullamore.
Okay.
Bring him down. Do you know Adam, who works in the show? I think he knows it as well.
Right, okay.
It's a great bowling alley.
Wait, sorry,
lots
there's bowling everywhere. How good is this bowling place in Tullamore?
Well, it's kind of central, you know. People can get to it from all their constituencies around the country. It's democratic, actually.
Well, my dad left the Guards. Sorry, when he retired from the Guards, he had a whopper do.
Did he?
I remember he had a whopper do. Yeah, they know how to party,
yeah.
As we know. I mean, you know, coppers, come on. Yeah. But the Guards, they know how to give you, send you off. You know what I mean? I'd say the nurses, they know how to give you a good send-off. You know, a good send-off. Have you ever been to a good send-off?
I'm still thinking about what he'll do on his new radio show. What he's going to play. What's his first track? What's his first track going to be? I don't know.
What are your tips for a leave and do? Did you have a good one?
And yeah. What do you give as a present?
And what do you give as a... Speaking of presents, give us your card that you have there. Sorry, just really quickly. Obviously, it was Graham's birthday yesterday. Yeah, yeah, we're over that
obviously.
Now.
Obviously.
Well, I was talking here. About it. I told the folks about it. I brought him in and I sang happy birthday to him.
I know.
He got a birthday card from his missus and he was right. It's a picture of a giant cat and it says, "This huge cat has been assigned to you. You must accept this situation and find joy in it." And how could you not find joy when you open it? Because it goes...
Meow, 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 meow. Yeah.
Wait.
Hang on, wait. It kicks in. Wait for the drop.
Banger.
Around the world, around the world.
New customers only, 12-month minimum term, requires broadband. Further terms apply.
Oh, lads, getting texts in. A lot of texts coming in, not really about leave and do's, right? But people are trying to figure out what his next move is. So, hi, Jen. Leo is obviously going to be the next Bond.
He could be. He can do the poker face thing or a nice cheese shop in Castleknock. A bespoke cheese shop in Castleknock.
With a good playlist.
A bespoke cheese shop in Castleknock,
yeah.
Or Bond.
Yeah. No, that's two options already.
That's two options. Get the options in. 51552. What is Leo's next move? I'd love to hear
from
you.
Get in touch. WhatsApp 087 187 9200.
Lips be the lover. My lips be the lover. like lipstick on my neck. You let me know I'm your number one select. I like lipstick on my neck. Hands around my waist so you know what's coming next. I wanna feel your lips on mine. I just wanna feel a little tongue. We don't have a long time. Ooh, you're talking nasty and I like it. Whisper in my ear, only me you can hear. I seen it from the back and I'm excited. Tell me what you do when we walk up in the room. Yeah, hold me something nasty, we can try it. You know what's coming next. We can make a movie, I can ride it. Let's just make a move, baby. Cause for your love I'll take my time. Just wanna feel your hips on mine. I really got a thing for my lipstick lover. Lover, 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 lover. I'll do anything for my lipstick lover. Lover, 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 lover. Lipstick on my neck. Leave a sticky icky in a place I won't forget. I like lipstick on my neck. Baby, I'm obsessed. Give me undressed. I wanna feel your lips on mine. I just wanna feel a little tongue. We don't have a long time. Ooh, you're talking nasty and I like it. Like it. Whisper in my ear, only me you can hear. I seen it from the back and I'm excited.
Good morning to Jen's Newsy Bits. It is 9:24. I'm here with Cormac and Graeme discussing the hot topics of the day. We're talking about Leo Varadkar's exit, his resignation, and we're trying to figure out what's he going to do now. A lot of texts coming in. Somebody said Leo's going to be the next Liverpool or Ireland football manager.
What? Is a trend, Jen. There's now another one saying Leo next Liverpool manager from Tony. What? And well, guys, Leo is defo the next Ireland football manager.
I think this texter has got it right. Leo's going to be on Dancing with the Stars and go on to become a professional dancer. He does love a bit of Dancing with the Stars. He does love it. Someone else says Leo is eloping with Kate Middleton.
Oh yeah, throw it in the pile.
There's lots of
theory.
Liverpool manager. There's loads of them. No. I think. Okay, maybe Dancing with the Stars, but that's not on for a while. I think he's going into the Big Brother house.
The Big Brother house.
I think he's going to go in.
What about a book? Has he done a book yet?
I was thinking about that.
A book.
A book on some random political historical thing.
Oh yeah, that's very good.
Yeah,
that's probably more likely to happen than him going on Dancing with the Stars. Let's be honest.
I still think he could. He'd be a good band manager, I would reckon. He'd be a good band manager. Lots of bands out there need some good managers. I think
you reckon he'd be a good manager?
Yeah, I'm not going to mention any specific bands, but I think he'd be a good one.
I think that's a terrible idea. I think the little cheese shop in Castleknock probably suit him better. Okay, yeah. What have you got for me?
Okay, so Kenny Chesney, he's this country star. He recognised Taylor Swift's talent, but did not know the impact that she would have on music and the world at large. So Kenny Chesney had his flip-flop summer tour in 2007.
Ah, come on.
Not like a flip-flop tour, is there?
Nice.
I love a flip-flop tour. It. Have you had a few of them?
Shut up, shop. Pull down the mics, turn off the lights and let's go.
Done.
We're done. We're
key finished. Off there, will you? So this flip-flop tour was meant to feature a then 17-year-old Taylor Swift as an opening act, but she was removed because a beer sponsor came on board and they couldn't have her, etc., etc. So he sent her a note and said, I'm really sorry you couldn't come on tour, but here's a little present. Gave her a load of money. She said she was able to pay her band bonuses, was able to pay for tour buses and fuel her dreams. This is what Taylor Swift said. But looking back, Kenny obviously doesn't regret...
Kenny with the flip-flop tour.
With the flip-flop tour.
Yeah.
Giving her the money. But he clearly was kind of catching on to the biggest music thing to probably happen in this century so far. So what were you first in the door with? What did you discover, Jen?
I discovered Amy Winehouse.
Did you, yeah? In some random jazz club.
Oh, yeah.
In Middle England.
You discovered her in Three Arena one night.
No.
15,000 other people.
No, I don't know if you know this. I might have mentioned it before, but I used to live in Bristol.
You did.
And in 2001, no. Maybe 2004. Maybe 2003. I can't remember. That time in my life is a bit of a blur. Okay. But it was years ago. I remember a friend of mine saying, let's go to Bristol University, right? Go to Bristol University. There's this singer on, right? Apparently she's really good. And I was like, oh my God, we have to go to university. So we went to the Bristol Uni bar and there was about 50 people in the room and this young one, no beehive, no nothing, just straight hair, a gorgeous size 12, stood up on stage and sang like a bird and her name is Amy Winehouse and I was like...
Not hope.
She's like, not great, is she? No, I knew there was something special. I was actually more interested in her guitar player, which had turned out to be one of her very good friends. And I actually interviewed him years later because he was on The Voice UK years later after Amy died. But I remember seeing Amy back then, stripped bare. She was only starting out. She was only a young one. I was like, God, she's not bad. She's not bad. And I was telling everybody about her. Amy Winehouse, you need to go see this Amy Winehouse. Amy Winehouse. And there we go. So I discovered Amy Winehouse.
And there was only a smattering of people around the place watching.
There was only a few people. Just students. She was just playing student unis around the country.
And did you even remember her name afterwards? Or was it when she became famous, you went, that's that girl I saw.
Yeah, because she sang a song, which is on her Frank album, I remember. And I was like, oh, I remember that song. And it all kind of came together. But she was unrecognizable. She was completely changed her look. Yeah. You know, she got the beehive and she was in all the 50s gear, whatever. And she didn't look like that when I saw her. But I was like, oh, you know, she might be good. She might, you know, she's potential. That one, potential. So there we go.
That's pretty impressive.
Thank you.
You discovered Amy Winehouse.
I did.
That's a stretch.
I want that on my tombstone.
Maybe Jen could be a band manager.
Oh, I'd be deadly.
Yeah.
Jen, you didn't discover.
No, I did.
You know what I mean?
No, I did.
Okay. You discovered Amy Winehouse. What did you discover?
I discovered chicken wings.
No, you didn't.
I did.
I think the Americans did.
Well, okay. Elephant and Castle, Temple Bar, the OG. No one knew about it in my tiny little circle as an 8-year-old. But as a big treat, if there was like a big birthday or anything, my parents would bring me and my sister there for dinner. And I couldn't get over the chicken wings. They were the best thing ever. And then I'd go back into school the next day and he'd be like, lads, this place is like mecca for food. And they were like, what the hell are you talking about? What is this place? Isn't it awesome? And now they're all over the place. There's about 50 million of them.
You must have, they're very spicy.
They're spicy
for an 8-year-old.
Yeah, and I'm not mad into spicy food, but I think there's so much butter.
Yes.
They're creamy spicy.
So you discovered chicken wings. Elephant Castle. Other restaurants available.
Other chicken wingeries are available. But I would like to dispute that because I discovered them in Elephant and Castle first.
He's way older.
I'm a little bit older than you. So I discovered them first. So you have to find something else. Off the top of your head.
Well, I think we should credit Elephant and Castle. Other restaurants are available. For bringing chicken wings to Ireland.
Yeah.
Because I doubt they existed before the Elephant and Castle.
I don't think they did. Everyone got on board, but it took a long time before the standard. It took about 15 years before the standard of chicken wing reached.
Who discovered the spice bag?
The spice bag.
Where did the spice bag come from now?
I don't know.
I have no idea. Actually, I've never had one.
Is it an Irish invention?
Yeah.
I have no idea. I don't know. Someone put something together and just magic happened in a bag.
I'd say you're always trying to get Emily onto certain bands and stuff like that. I'd say, trying to get... Oh, go on.
According to RTE reporter Liam Geraghty, the dish was created in 2010 by the Sunflower Chinese Takeaway in Temple Oak, Dublin.
Good on him.
I discovered that I was the first person in the world to take a pair of Doc Martin boots and colour in the yellow the yellow thread. Kind of thread that goes around them with a black Sharpie. Thousands of people do it now.
Everyone was doing that. No, they weren't.
I was the first person in the world to do that. And now millions of people do that when they get them new.
Why do you do that?
Because I just didn't like the look of the yellow lacing or the yellow threading that went around the sole. So I just put them in, buy them new and just go straight around it with a marker and make them all black.
Can
fully
I ask you
black.
A question?
You can.
How many pairs of Docs do you reckon you've had in your life?
Honestly, I'd say 40.
They last a long
time. Honestly, I used to get 10 pairs a year.
Wait, how do you 40? They take about 2 years to break in.
I'm exaggerating for theatre, radio, all that kind of stuff. No. Yeah. I'd say probably 15 pairs. I've ruined a few pairs as well. But I did that was my thing, and I was way ahead of the curve on that one. So anyone who's doing that, I was the first person.
Producer Kate thinks she discovered Friends. Because everybody was watching Father Ted. She went into school and she was like, I didn't watch Father Ted last night. I was watching this new thing called Friends and opened all their eyes. So it's her fault.
So she
it's actually her fault.
That we have endless repeats of Friends on
that
the TV.
That is Kate Proctor's fault.
Yeah.
Fact. Okay, so what did you bring to your friends and family first? Okay, you might not have discovered it. Me is Amy Winehouse, which is quite impressive.
Chicken wings
is very impressive. Colouring in the laces on your Docs.
Not so good. Not great.
That's because you're the oldest, but we'll move on.
Let's go.
Hey now, honey, I've been driving around in my car, looking for some kind of open bar. It's gonna be alright, gonna be alright. Got no money, but I'll work it out with my charm. Having a good time, ain't doing no harm. It's gonna be alright, gonna be alright. Hey now, honey, I've been driving around in my car, looking for some kind of open bar. It's gonna be alright, gonna be alright. Got no money, but I'll work it out with my charm. Having a good time, ain't doing no harm. It's gonna be alright, gonna be alright. Having a good time, ain't doing no harm. It's gonna be alright, gonna be alright. Hey.
it.
Ah, lads, there's a lot of people out there who've discovered a lot of cool stuff.
This one is amazing.
If it's true.
If it's true. Jen, a friend of mine from Liverpool was drinking with a few lads in his local pub who said to him, "We're working on a new song. Take this home, have a listen and tell us what you think." He took it home, listened to it, thought it was a load of rubbish, met up with them the next night and told them it was a load of rubbish and just gave up. The song was Relax and the lads went on to call themselves Frankie Goes to Hollywood.
Come on! Is that... No way!
We need this person on the phone.
That's unbelievable.
If wow. it's true. Yeah,
if it's true. It's true.
I mean...
If it's true.
It just shows that your friend has terrible taste in music. Not terrible taste in music, but doesn't know a good tune because that went on to become one of the most successful songs of the 80s.
But yeah, but also, one of the most...
What do you mean it changed everything?
Well,
one of the most hated songs of the 80s by the older brigade.
Yeah.
Because it was very risque. The music video and everything was like completely out of its time.
An S&M video, it was very it frightened the establishment. It frightened politicians, it frightened parents, it frightened everything. It was kind of like the new Sex Pistols. It was just...
Was it promoting safe sex? It was just promoting...
It was definitely promoting sex.
Yeah.
Yeah, I don't know.
Can I get a clip of that song, Adam, just so we can remind ourselves?
Get the 8-minute extended version.
Okay, so that caller, that texter had a friend who listened to Frankie Goes to Hollywood before.
There's a lot of latex involved.
Was there?
Have Dan
on the line.
Go on.
He discovered something. Dan, how's it going?
How are things? How are you getting on?
Not too bad. Where in the country are you?
Cork.
Lovely. So I discovered Amy Winehouse, which is pretty impressive.
Pretty big, all right.
Thank you. Graham thinks he discovered chicken wings, but that's been debunked because they've been in Elephant Castle since 1989 in Temple Bar, and Graham wasn't born then.
Yeah, no.
So what have you got that we can try and debunk? Go on.
So poached eggs in the microwave is a big game changer. So
how?
So, I suppose, first of all, it creates less of a mess. And there is a bit of a technique to poaching eggs. And there's a lot of gadgets and gizmos that do it for you. But if you just fill up a bowl slightly with boiling water, crack an egg, drop it into it, put it into the microwave for 55 seconds to a minute, you'll have a perfectly poached egg. You can lift it out with the spoon. No mess.
You discovered this yourself.
Yes, I do believe I did, yes. Yeah.
Wait. I do believe I did.
What did you try before that, Dan? How did you get to the 55-second mark and the amount of water and everything else?
Yeah, it's a lot of testing, to be honest. Mm-hmm. I mean, I like mine slightly runny, so I find that 55 seconds does that perfectly. If you put a cover on it then, there's a bit of a difference, depending on the microwave. You know, there's a lot involved in it, so there's a lot of research put into it.
Wow, do you have a lab coat?
I don't. No. I.
You'd need one, wouldn't you?
No,
if people come and stay, they're like, make us one of your poached eggs in the microwave.
For sure. Yeah, I've done videos. I've sent them onto WhatsApp groups. You know, notes have dropped. It's a real game changer. To be honest,
that's your legacy. That's your legacy, Dan.
Is it on YouTube?
Yeah. It's not. No, I didn't want to get it out there too much.
No.
It does a perfect poached egg in 1 minute. There's no mess. It's quick and easy. You can put two in if you like, but then the time varies with two.
Okay.
So you need to kind of bring it up a bit, maybe a minute 20 seconds.
Dan, I love it. I love it. Fair play to you. That is some discovery. Thank you so much for getting in touch with the show. Now he's off the phone. I just want to shit all over that, okay, for a second.
Why?
You're putting too much thought into trying to do a perfect poached egg. I do an amazing poached egg. I am the queen of poached eggs, right? And it's all to do with the freshness and not have the water bubbling too much so it doesn't ruin it. You don't need any gadgets. You don't need vinegar. You don't need any gizmos. You don't need a microwave. All you need is a fresh, fairly fresh egg and boil the water and you just throw it in and that is it. That is it. Why do people get so hung up? Why they're like, oh, we need that poached egg thing. We need the, you know, we need to put vinegar in and they taste the vinegar. No, you don't. You don't. You don't need any of that.
Jen, you need to make us a poached egg.
I'm very good at making poached eggs.
Does anyone else know this trick? Maybe everybody does, but I just want to ask anyway, that you swirl the water with a... yeah, okay, everyone knows that. I won't
don't. You don't need to do that. You don't need to do any of that. I'm telling you. Jen, please advise people to be so careful with an egg in the microwave. My mum left it in the microwave too long and it exploded in her face and neck and she had second-degree burns, poached eggs in the microwave, burn has a trip to A. Yeah. Dad has it down to a fine art, it sounds. He's been practising, whatever. Yeah, I don't think you need to. I just think boiling water, don't have it too hot.
Don't have boiling water too hot. It's boiling.
But you know the when it bubbles and it's kind of messy.
Yeah, I know what you're saying.
You know, it's not, it doesn't move too much. And then you put the eggs in and it's fine. That's all. Stop the overthinking.
I just love that, what you just said though. Don't have boiling water too hot.
Don't have it too hot. Oh, go on.
Yeah.
So some lad listened to that and said, nah, that's a load of shite.
He was a complete square, whoever this lad was. That is an amazing tune.
Oh, it's objectively unbelievable. Unbelievable tune. My dad would leave the room every time it would come on.
So, what am I saying here? To throw censors off the scent, when Relax first came out, the band claimed publicly that it was written about motivation. Later they confessed it was actually about tennis.
It was motivation, okay. But it's... okay, Frankie, the lyrics are relatively ambiguous, although the line, when you want to come, is clearly a reference to tennis.
We don't need to point that out, do we?
Oh, it's a guide to delaying your ace.
What does that mean?
It's karmic.
No, you don't have to explain.
Let me, get me a pen and paper.
Rising.
Never been good at waiting till you showed me patience. How you know me? Yeah, it shows me I was the one needing saving. Put my cape on my back when it felt unattached, when I was at my lowest. You saw Superman. It's a bird, it's a plane. Oh, call me your Superman. Dun, 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 Superman. Forever. Motive when you hold me, and I'm running faster than a speeding bullet just to get right to your face. Put my cape on my back when it felt unattached, when I was at my lowest. You saw Superman. It's a bird, it's a plane. Oh, it's me, baby. Call me your Superman. Dun-dun-dun, Superman. Whatever I do, tweet, tweet, tweet. Put my cape on my back when it felt unattached, when I was at my lowest. You saw Superman. Superman, dun, 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 Superman, Superman. I'll be your Superman. I'll be your Superman. Woo! Save you, I'll save you when you need saving.
And Graham discussing the topics of the day. We're a bit giddy today, aren't we?
We're trying to discuss the topics of
we
the day.
We are discussing. Dan discovered doing poached eggs in the microwave. Come on.
Yeah.
That is amazing. What did you discover? 51552. I want to talk about Louis Walsh for a second because I'm not watching Big Brother, but he's all over the internet. And the good, and it's looking that he might win the bloody thing, okay? But Kirsty Blake Knox has a piece about Louis Walsh in The Independent today. And it's been reported that Louis Walsh is the highest paid contestant on this year's Celebrity Big Brother. Shan Osborne was a guest lodger as they couldn't settle on a fee. She says, given the volume of coverage Walsh, who's 71, has generated during his time in the house, I'd wager the producers think he was well worth it. Aside from being the most famous pop manager to come out of Ireland, he is also one of Ireland's most successful reality TV stars. What makes him so successful?
But he's the only person I know that's in Celebrity Big Brother. I don't know anyone else.
He has verbal diarrhea. He knows how to play a crowd. He knows what's going to get him airtime, and that is by being pretty nasty, I would say. But is it an act? I think it's all an act. I don't think he's genuinely like that. He's become known for his unfiltered, forthright, and sometimes scathing sound bites. So he says these really horrible things and dresses it up as him being honest. Right, I just get myself in trouble. I just say it how it is. I'm just completely honest. I'm like, no, that's not an excuse. That's just mean. Anyway, one of the biggest headlines he generated was for calling Jedward vile. Okay, and he might argue I'm entitled to my opinion, but But that's, you know, verbal abuse, really. You're calling someone vile. Vile, but I want to talk about the word vile because I haven't heard it in such a long time and he's brought it back and I'm raging about that. It's a word you don't really hear nowadays, do you? You don't really, oh, they're vile. They're vile. Do you?
Reserved. I think it's one of those reserved, like the C word that you put in really, you only, it's a break glass and emergency word that you take out very, very rarely. I think vile is a, it's like it's a really super nasty word.
It's a vile word.
Yeah, it is a vile word. Yeah,
and it's one I'd never use it. I think I might use it a bit more now since it's brought to my attention. Vile is pretty rough. Interesting as well that there's not many managers as well that can say that they're more famous than the bands that they manage. There's not many of them.
That's very true.
Which is an unusual thing, but that's the way Louis rolls. But vile is a pretty nasty word.
It's a nasty word, but don't bring it back. No. I don't want to start using that again. It just got me thinking about words that I hate. Absolutely. Vile is up there. Vile is up there.
Was it up there before you read this, though? Did you kind of forget about it and then you're like, oh, yeah.
I did. I was like, nobody was using it for a long time. And then Louis Walsh, out he comes.
If you describe someone as being vile, like, everything is wrong, isn't it?
Everything is wrong there. Yeah. And I wouldn't see, you know, Jedward being vile.
No.
I would use many other words. But vile is not what, you know what I mean?
No.
Like they're harmless lads out there having a good time and they've done so well. Regardless of that, I want to talk about the words that you hate, okay? I get letters sent in to me, not for a word, but for a sentence I use sometimes, okay? Because people forget when I'm on the telly, I have a live studio audience, right? And sometimes I play to them and it's all, I'm loud, I'm getting them going and... Yeah. I have a huge
audience.
We're
all ready for a good time. Come on, everyone.
Give it up for.
Oh, yeah. Give it up
for. Give it up for riles people up. I'm like,
why?
I have no idea. And I have taken note. I'm like, okay, well, I won't use it as much. You know what I mean? For that one person that handwrites me letters.
What do you say instead, though?
Let's hear it for.
I don't know. Give it up. Let's hear it for. You know, it's a cutoff point. It's like I need to get rid of them. You know what I mean? And it's a kind of a go-to.
I don't find it that terribly annoying as a phrase.
But it gets to a certain point. So much so that they feel a need to handwrite. You know what I mean? Like there's certain things. Like vile would be for me. I'd be handwriting letters to the BBC.
Armpit. About that. Armpit. I don't like the word armpit.
Why not? Do you not like armpits?
Do you like the word armpit?
I wouldn't have a problem with armpit.
Oxter.
What?
Oxter. Isn't that an armpit as well? Anything around the armpit area just doesn't... Oxter is a
But arm and
word.
Pit as like...
As a
word,
a compound word.
Yeah.
Armpit.
It's no, just what it represents.
Yeah, well, that's the whole thing. That's what words are all about.
I think when you get to a certain age as well...
That's the way it works.
You shouldn't be allowed to say stuff. Like, I don't know. There's certain words like with a Y on the end.
Yeah.
I had a friend who was in his late 20s, 30s and still called his mother mummy. You do that.
Yeah.
Yeah, sorry, forgot. You do that.
What do you mean you forgot? I do. We all do in our family.
Mummy.
Yeah. Oh, God. I know. Is that problematic? Is that dodgy?
Yeah.
In a kind of a Freudian dodgy
a little bit
way?
It's a little bit. Yeah, it's
mummy.
It's not good.
It is a bit.
Nobody wants to hear that.
If you've seen Bad Sisters, and the bad character who they refer to as the R-I-C-K, he refers to his wife as Mammy. Doesn't he? In Bad Sisters.
Yeah.
Have anyone seen Bad Sisters? He calls her Mammy. It's the weirdest thing.
Yeah.
Sharon Horgan, she wrote that. That was a very good trick.
I caught myself calling now Daddy.
Did you?
No.
Mm.
Not.
Was it? No, it wasn't in that scenario. It was like, we're getting into the car. Daddy, where's the keys? I've found myself doing that and I wanted to just go up into the Wicklow Mountains and never come back again. The man, I read this as well, the man behind the Willy Wonka-inspired event, remember that, in Scotland? Mm. He says the event ruined his life and made him sick to the pit of his tummy.
No.
Tummy.
He
you
said
can't
tummy.
Say tummy when you're a grown man.
You can't. And you can't say mummy. And then with Y.
Yeah.
I feel. It's tricky. I
Do you know what's really annoying? The word ick. I can't stand that word.
I think we're all done with that word.
Sorry, I nearly swore there. I just think we need to stop saying it, please. Everybody, we're done with the word ick. Don't say something gives me the ick anymore. We're post ick, right?
But while we're on ick, we're also post. We're not in COVID anymore. So can people stop saying staycation? I just can't with staycation. Staycation with the hubby.
Oh my God.
That whole sentence needs to be thrown and locked away in a dark dungeon somewhere.
With the babogues.
Oh God.
A staycation with my hubby and the babogues.
Oh my God,
what a sentence.
I can't wait for me holly bobs because we're doing a staycation with me hubby and the babogues.
Holly bobs. Somebody says
I hate poxy. I love poxy.
Poxy's a great word.
This person's not from Dublin.
That's
moist and the C word. C word. My American friend came over recently and C word was dropped and she went, oh my God, I love that word. You guys say it so well. We don't use that word in America.
There's an aggression to it.
They're too polite.
Jen, can I give you a word that's worse than the C word that I'm allowed to say on radio, but people will probably get sick out the windows in their car right now?
Sure.
Phlegm.
Nah, it's all right.
I can't. Even saying phlegm it, I feel bad. Like I'm about to get phlegm. Sick into the mic.
Interesting phone. Spelling as well. But
is there an Irish name? Oh, no, it's Phelim. Kind of similar.
Awful.
The word pregnant makes me feel physically sick. Pregnant. What is wrong with pregnant? I don't know why. Even after having three of my own children, I still hate the word. Oh, this is a good one. Do you see that one, Graeme?
Oh, no.
Go on.
Do I have to read this?
Oh.
Yeah.
Jen, anytime I hear the word girly or girlies, hate it so much. Are we going away on a girly trip or are we going on a girly night out? Vibe is also up there. Yeah, I agree with vibe as well. Thanks, Jen. Helping me vent my frustration from Lynn in Mace.
Go on, Lynn. I called I call my husband daddy all the time. 14 years separated. I still call him daddy. Oh, hang they're on. Separated.
I'm recoiling from a text on the screen. That's weird.
Okay. I'm not going to give you poxy. Poxy is a great word. 51552, those words that you absolutely hate. Give it up for Cormac and Graeme on today's Jen's Newsy Bits.
And it's Bette da Silva, and we are back for another week of new selections and big tunes from the likes of Pillow Queens with Like a Lesson. Even more homegrown music in the mix with Finch and The State.
They told me to work harder and be smarter.
And one of my favorite tunes is back on the playlist, Rachel Chinnery, Never Need Me. In with me on the new music show tonight from 7. 2FM.
Entertainment news sponsored by Comfort Fabric Conditioner with fragrances to match every mood. Discover your favorite comfort fragrance.
Connor Bean is here with the story. What have you got?
So Megan Fox has gotten very candid about plastic surgery in a new interview. She's a guest on Call Her Daddy, the podcast that came out this week. And she went into detail about what procedures she's had done and what she hasn't had done. There's a short clip here, a montage that Page Six has put together of what she talks about. We'll play this and then we've some few things to discuss afterwards.
Okay, let's have a listen.
I'm just going to go through all the things that I've done. I had my boobs done when I was 21 or 22. Okay. I had my nose done when I was in my early 20s. There's one thing I had done that I'm gatekeeping. I've never had a facelift of any kind. I've never done threads. I've never had this on. What is this?
Oh, buckle fat.
I've never had any like liposuction or body contouring or anything like that.
So here's what's interesting. She said she had a boob job at 21, 22. Then after she was done breastfeeding, she had another one. And then recently had to have that fixed, basically. She said she didn't have enough body fat and the implants were visible and she wasn't happy with that. And then she noted she's only had the one nose job. But because she contours her nose so much, people constantly go, "You've had five or six nose jobs." She's like, "No, I just sit at home and just give the nose a good go, so you can see into." And this is what I thought was really interesting. Despite the fact that she's had a number of surgeries, she says she doesn't actually like doing them and says, "When I go to have one, it's a very big deal. All my doctors have to meet with me before and have to tell me if they've seen any omens, if they've seen any owls, crows, if anyone stepped on a spider, if there are any dead insects. My doctors have to go through this with me because I'm very afraid of dying under general anesthesia." She doesn't want anybody to do anything crazy, but like she has gone through a bunch of these and says you get criticized for talking about this if you say you've had it done or if you don't have it done. I'm a bit like, it's a lot for one person, but I appreciate the honesty.
I don't mind that. I'm just still in shock of the age she had it done.
I know.
21, 22.
Do you know what I will not, I say as well? I've been listening to this interview and I'm about 30 minutes into it. I haven't gotten to this part, but already 30 minutes in, she spoke about how from like literally 5, 6, 7, she had like body dysmorphia and didn't think she looked like she looked like. And look, the whole thing with Megan Fox is she got famous very young and we all were like, she is the best looking woman you've ever seen. And for her in her head, she never joined those dots. So not to pathologize anybody, but when you go through that young, it's not surprising that you get bits done. And like she said, she's not encouraging other people to do it, but I do like when celebs go, "Well, I had my boobs done," because so many are like, "I just drink a lot of water," and I'm like, "What, did it go straight to your boobs?" Like, you know, at least she's honest.
Thanks, Connor.
Text Jen 51552.
Sing it in a song, you can smoke it in a bong, smoking pot.
Pot.
Well, it's the latest sensation that's sweeping the nation, smoking pot.
Let's go!
Let's go smoke some pot. 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 Come on, let's go smoke some pot. Well, there was Eddie Brickell and the new Bohemian smoking pot.
Pot.
Well, there's the Black Crows and driving and crying smoking pot. Smoke some pot. Let's go smoke some pot. Let's go smoke some pot. Come on. Let's go smoke some pot.
Let's go!
I smoked too much pot.
Pot.
I went to Lollapalooza and everybody out there was smoking pot.
Pot.
I saw Blind Melon and the Red Hot Chili Peppers and Pearl Jam and Widespread Panic.
Let's go smoke some pot! Let's go smoke some pot! Let's go smoke some pot! Let's go smoke some pot!
Come on! Let's go smoke some pot!
Let's go!
Watch me heap up what I sow. I'm made of peanuts and out of shells. God spares a quality of himself. Unique design, but we can't help ourselves. So why? That bugs you. I won't sign conversation around you. I made a face that bugs you.
the 21st of March. Good morning. If you'd like to get in touch with the show, you can. You can text me on 51552. You can also send me a voice note on our WhatsApp, 0871879200. Good morning. Okay, so let's talk about this. Give Us the Night are an independent volunteer group of professionals operating within the nighttime industry. They are campaigning for positive changes to nightlife in Ireland, with particular focus on music venues. Their aim is to highlight the contribution of nighttime industry to culture, community and the economy in Ireland, and to raise the quality of nightlife to international standards, because we're not there, are we? Far from it. Well, I'm joined now in studio by Robbie Kitt, who is a DJ and producer from Dublin and member of the Give Us the Night team, and we've spoken before, and Robbie is here. Hello.
Hello again.
Hello again. We were just talking off air. I can't believe this campaign, you said, is 20 years old.
Yeah, yeah. I've only been involved for the last six, but Sunil Sharp, the founder of the campaign, founded it in 2004. So, yeah, these problems have been kind of ongoing and quite long standing.
And fair play to everybody involved, for because you're still banging on that door and trying to get stuff done. And for those who are not familiar with this campaign or its motives, can you just tell us a bit about the problem that exists and why you feel the need to make a change?
Yeah, well, I suppose you kind of touched on it in the intro. Like, in the kind of the general aim of the campaign is to modernise conditions in Ireland's kind of, as they call it, nighttime economy for music venues, late night music venues, but particularly, I suppose, nightclubs, dance spaces. Like, for us, I think a big concern for us is the access to dance spaces in this country. Like, so something that we've kind of highlighted a lot with the campaign is the eradication of dance floor spaces. And so, a stat that we've trotted out a lot of the time is in 2001, there was like 522 nightclubs in the country. Now, today, there's like 89 nightclubs in the country. A recent stat, actually, that Sunil found was that in 1952, there was over 1,200 licensed dance halls in the country. So, like, I suppose just even thinking about, you know, often I think we think about Ireland of the past and how conservative it was, but it's, I think, kind of shocking to me that they actually had greater access to dance spaces than we do today. In terms of the problems that are faced by these kind of businesses that are trying to operate in the nighttime economy, they're like, there's so many. Like, you know, at the end of the day, I think, you know, what needs to be recognized, these businesses aren't typically massive profit-making businesses already, you know. Cultural businesses, and like anybody who works in the cultural sector will tell you, it's not the most lucrative industry to get into, unless you find yourself maybe at the very top of the industry. So, you know, and like, even like, you know, there's a lot of spaces out there that are actually cultural spaces that we think could act as really suitable dance floor spaces, but they're subsidized spaces. A lot of, like, you know, theaters and art spaces, these are already subsidized to function, you know. So it's a very challenging environment for these businesses anyway. But then there's issues like insurance, which is a massive one, but something that we've been focusing particularly on has been licensing, which kind of relates to the permissions on how cultural businesses and late night music venues are kind of allowed to function late at night, particularly after 12 o'clock at night.
We'll get to that in a second, but let's talk about the benefits and why it's so important to get these spaces active and people in them.
Yeah, well, like, I think, like, I love dancing, you know, and I think dancing is special, you know. I think it's quite a unique experience for people to have, you know, to be in a physical space with other people and be moving your body in response to music. As simple as that sounds, I think that's kind of a special thing to be doing. So on a basic level, I think, you know, that is a pretty healthy activity. But I think in a wider sense, particularly when it comes to young people, like, we have to recognize that there is no real access for young people these days to any sort of diverse array of social spaces at night for them to go out and to build the foundations of their lives. And I think particularly when we're like living in an age which has become so digital, and I suppose digital social technologies have kind of taken over a lot of our lives. You know, we all spend, I'm sure, too much time on the phone. And I think there's even a lack of recognition in that when you're on the phone, you know, you're not engaged in as kind of I don't want to say normal, but like, it's in a, you know, an organic social experience with another human being, you know what I mean? And I think in the wake of that, like, we're kind of, you know, For me, I think it's just a really kind of simple basic need of our society that we have this social infrastructure. And I think we actually also have to recognize how challenging it is for those businesses, considering that their competition now is Netflix and Instagram and TikTok. And so our aim has always been to create a more diverse nighttime economy, such that there's cultural businesses that can actually, I suppose, attract people out of their houses and into our cities and towns across the country, and just engage them in, you know, normal physical activity.
Blowing off steam and interacting with people from different cohorts of society and having fun and getting out of their faces,
it's
out of their phones.
It's kind of depressing to have to talk about it in those terms, but that's exactly what we're after. Yeah, you know what I mean? And it is missing in our society at the moment, I think.
One of the proposals being put forward is a nighttime economy advisors. Can you explain what the role would be there and how would that operate?
So basically, as I said, kind of like the campaign has been working on a few different fronts.
Yeah.
And so this work kind of came out of our work with the Department of Culture through this body that we've established during COVID called the Nighttime Economy Task Force. And so we've been able to achieve a lot of things through that body, because it's, I suppose, a real aim of us of our campaign has been to establish like the cultural importance of this type of activity within our economy. And so working with the Department of Culture, it kind of makes sense for us to be doing that work with them. They established these nighttime economy advisors in, I think, 9 pilot situations in towns and cities across the country. Dublin has one, Cork, Limerick. They're dotted all around the country, but there's also places in, like, Buncrana has one. So for small towns and large cities. Essentially, the role will be operating within local authorities. So they'll be in the councils and they'll be working with local authorities. The idea, I think, is to create kind of a bridge between, I suppose, the stakeholders in the nighttime economy, because there's a lot of issues and there's a lot of challenges that are, like, you know, face businesses, but also people who are, like, living in towns and cities. And often, I think, we approach nightlife from the point of view of the problems that it brings, and we don't really kind of have advocates that can, I suppose, advocate for the positive side of those things. So, I'd hope that nighttime economy advisor position can advance some of those things, but at the same time, it has to be said, like, there's, like, you know, that we'll get on to talking about, I'm sure, but the opening hours and, like, the licensing reform that has been announced and was kind of, it should have really been in place by now for the appointment of these kind of officials. So without that kind of reform, it's kind of, they're a little bit hamstrung in what they can do.
So where are we with the reform? I mean, how far have we gotten them and what do we need to do?
It's still ongoing. Like, you know, listen, at the end of the day, my experience with this government is that they're very good at announcing things that they're going to do, but sometimes when it comes to actually doing those things, they're not great at following through. So I suppose, just give your listeners a little bit of an outline of what that reform is. I suppose a lot of people have heard about, you know, opening hours being extended in the news. So what this relates to is basically something called the sale of alcohol bill. And the sale of alcohol bill basically relates to how alcohol is sold in any kind of context in the country. And the government, at the start of their government, said that they were going to reform this bill. Like, we're dealing within that bill with incredibly conservative, kind of archaic systems that date back to the 19th century. So it's been long standing that this bill requires reform. But I suppose also this bill really limits the type of activity that cultural businesses can engage in, because they don't really have full access to, you know, the range of commodities available in the nighttime economy, to put it in those terms.
Sure.
So basically, it's because their behavior and their functions are so curtailed, it really throws up a massive barrier to those kind of businesses. Now, the reality is that, like, in these laws won't change things overnight. There's still massive issues in relation to insurance and the fact that these kind of businesses aren't incredibly profitable in the first place. But I suppose these permissions have to be changed such that businesses can actually open late. And, like, we have some of the earliest closing hours in Ireland. We don't have anything such as a late night license in Ireland. If you want to go late in this country, you have to pay for a license every single night that you go late. And the cost of it is the equivalent of what it costs annually in some other countries to have a late license. So these are the kind of things that are changing. In terms of where we're at with it, the provisional legislation was published in 2022. And now it still hasn't actually been published and presented to the Dáil. So we're still waiting for that bill to be published. We're under the impression that that will hopefully happen in the coming weeks. But what
have
we
have you been saying that for a long time?
We have been told this as well. And so, you know, listen, that's just the information that we have. But again, we're getting this information from the government, and again, they're not often true to their word in this regard. It breaks my heart, unfortunately. But also, what we're under the impression is that this bill will be actually significantly reduced from the first published legislation. So it's going to deal with essentially late night opening hours and the kind of the rules that apply to venues. We still have to remain to see what the content of those that reform will be. But hopefully, I think there's the intention that this will be in brought in before the summer. That's pretty ambitious from what I hear talking to people who kind of deal with legislation.
So while that's happening in the background and yes, you're trying to make Ireland a better place for the young people, give them somewhere to go and have a bit of a dance, what is happening in the meantime? Are these, like, what are you guys, like producers and musicians and DJs? I mean, I see these nights crop up and pop up across the city and, well, mainly in Dublin. Is that how you're trying to get around to try and get people back dancing?
It's like, yeah, again, like I think the main issue really is access to space. Like space. That, and that is kind of like, you know, as we kind of documented in the loss of infrastructure in relation to the loss of nightclubs. Like, if you're talking about losing 400 spaces in the last 20 years where people could go and dance, that's going to have a huge knock-on effect for cultural communities who want to use those spaces for events. And the situation now on the ground for cultural communities is that they just don't really have access to space. And in a wider sense, I think, you know, how property is treated in our national economy, the use of property for cultural and kind of social uses, it's not really prioritized. That's not really, I think, high up on the government's agenda. For me, it's a massive blind spot because I think it means that basically you kind of ignore this social and emotional health that needs to be considered of the general population, particularly when it comes to young people, I think, and like being able to build their futures here. But like for older people as well, I'm 33 and I still want to go out and I want to keep on dancing until I get into my 40s and 50s. And I don't really see a future for me doing that in Ireland.
You need to go to Berlin.
Yes, but this is the thing. And like, I suppose those kind of examples show you how you can use different types of infrastructure for events. Like, one of the things about Ireland is that we're kind of hamstrung in that the only place you can really organise a late night event in this country is in a pub. This is not to knock pubs. I love pubs. They're a very important part of our cultural infrastructure. But at the same time, only having that space to organise an event in, even from a practical point of view, like if you're an event organiser trying to organise something in a pub, the pub owner is typically only interested in the bar take and they're not really interested in the quality of the event that you're putting on. If you're running that event in a, you know, a culturally designated space, then typically that kind of dynamic changes. So something that we've been trying to do, particularly through the Nighttime Economy Task Force, is activate publicly funded art spaces, you know, because a lot of these spaces are sitting absolutely idle after 9 o'clock, 10 o'clock. There's no use of them. And like, really, there's not that much needed for a dance floor, a dance spaces. A lot of these kind of publicly funded art spaces as well are highly accessible. They've already kind of received a lot of grants to kit themselves out to be really accessible spaces. And even if we take, for example, like the National Concert Hall ran the Haunted Dance Hall, the first iteration of it went until 3 o'clock in the morning. This was in 2022. And like something like that, I think, is like a really good illustration of what the capacity of our national cultural institutions are. You know, it should be noted as well, within their licensing criteria, the National Concert Hall can actually open at any time. So they are actually not curtailed by the same kind of rules that are, you know, kind of inhibit different types of businesses in the nighttime economy. They can go till 6-7 o'clock in the morning if they want to. They don't really want to, but at the same time, the space is there and it's desperately needed by cultural communities. So in the kind of waiting for the government to kind of get their skates on with this legislation, we've been kind of trying to activate these other types of cultural spaces and show how theatres, galleries, these kind of spots could be really desperately useful for cultural communities who are just starved of space and access to it.
Thank you so much for coming in and chatting about this. It's a really, really important thing to get involved in. If you feel strongly about it or you want more information, what can people do? And if you need help and support, what are you asking people for?
Yeah, listen, we always say, like, follow us on our socials. I think in the next coming, like, in the coming weeks, this legislation in terms of licensing reform is going to be published and it's going to be debated in the Dáil. And so, you know, we're going to be definitely ramping up our activity. We're going to be trying to make sure that the kind of the criteria that we've advocated for in relation to the benefits of this reform reaching cultural businesses stays in the bill. So we're going to need support on that. Something that you can do, I know it's saying, and it's like people always say it, write to your local representatives, but it does actually matter. If you could like write to your TDs and tell them and express to them how important, you know, access to dance spaces, access to cultural spaces at night, how kind of the absence of that in your social life is, you know, really, I think, dangerous for our society as a whole, really, in a lot of ways. So, you know, expressing that to your local representatives matters because, to be honest, those local representatives are going to be debating this legislation in the coming weeks in the Dáil. So any support in that regard is really, really important.
Well said. There we go. DJ and producer Robbie Kidd, thank you so much for coming into the studio. And you can go to the website. Give Us the Night is the website. Give Us the Night website.
The Instagram, probably the best. Probably,
okay, yeah, Instagram. And it's Give Us the Night on Instagram?
Yeah, Give Us the Night, yeah.
Give Us the Night on Instagram. I'd love to hear from you on this. What do you think of this? Do you feel that this is something missing in society? And would you be inclined to write to your local councillor? Get in touch. 51552. We'll be back with more after this.
Two FM.